friends, and welcome back to another Bolo Versus video, the series where I pit sci-fi's toughest and biggest tanks against any sci-fi franchise I dang well feel like it. I'm going to apologize in advance if my sound is a little bit off this week. I have recently had a tooth extracted because it broke in half while eating sushi. Because apparently that is my luck. Hear that? You heard it here first. I broke a tooth eating sushi. So, now that I've gotten that other idiocy out of the way, let's carry on, shall we? This episode is going to be a little bit different, but still just as interesting in my opinion. Whereas I'd normally spend about 3 weeks doing insane amounts of research, playing with battle charts, writing and rewriting the scenario, then doing a solid week of editing and filming. Boom, baked entertainment.
FBI, open up!
But because there's very little lore surrounding the adversaries this time around, and even less data about the weapon outputs, metallurgical analysis, and the like, I'm going to have to infer a lot about damage scaling and output. So I'm going to keep things grounded in real-world science as best I can, so damage outputs will be based on what is known mathematically in universe, or best educated guess based on alpha canon material. We're going to see if pre-collapse Earth from the Bolo universe, approximately 2021 era, can survive an invasion by the Espheni from falling skies. And you're going to see why this match is going to be extremely different when we break down our combatants in just a moment. The scenario is going to play out differently as well. Given the scales of the combatants and the type of warfare that's going to be used, attempting to keep track of all the battles using standard chart and plot method quickly becomes onerous to the point where this video would be about 40 minutes long.
Ain't nobody got time for that!
So this time around, we'll discuss the single most obvious strategic plan and how it's going to wind up playing out. And I feel this should be the most fair, and it should be in the most spirit of the video. So we'll go with that. So, let's first dive into our combatants, their strengths, their weaknesses, and something special for this episode. I'm going to introduce what's called the wildcard category. The wildcard is going to be a one or two immutable points about the combatant. They could either be benefits, or detriments, or both. We'll see how it plays out. Alright, let's start with pre-collapse Earth. The lore of the geopolitics of this period is just as sparse of that and their adversaries, but again, we're going to infer some basics. That there will be several major continental superpowers at the heights of their power, having spent a decade or more stockpiling preparing for another world war. No individual supranational state will be suffering from any attrition at this point, and for the sake of the video, I'm just going to break it down into four areas, like this. First up is going to be the Federation of the Americas, including both North and South America. The EU, which is also going to include Russia, India, and Australia, the entire African Union, and everything else was going to be wrapped up into the Pan-Pacific Union. And I know this is just a hugely oversimplified, childish approach to the pre-Concordiat Earth, but just bear with me on this. It's just for the sake of ease of the video, guys. So we're going to assign each of these unions a number of regiments consummate with their contemporary real-world power scaling. And just to make it roughly easy, it's going to be an even 60 tanks per regiment, 4 squadrons of 15. I know that's not traditional or real, but it's my video. And given that value is not only an investment of resources, but strategy as well, I'm going to infer that a Mark II and a Mark III Bolo represent a 5-to-1 and a 3-to-1 investment in resources in that order. And because I don't feel like doing the math twice, I'm just going to average it 4-to-1. Again, my video. So, after a quick lazy Google search, we get there's about 70,000 tanks give or take in the world, with some caveats. So, here's how I'm going to play this out. So for the Federation of the Americas, we're going to go with 10,000 tanks give or take. So that's going to be about 2,500 Bolos, or 41.66 regiments, or 40 regiments for people who want easy round numbers, like me. We're going to divide it 60-40 north and south. So 25 regiments in North America, Central America, and 15 in the south. The EU is going to get the lion's share at 30,000, thanks Russia and Germany, so they're going to get 125 regiments of tanks in total. The African Union has got 6,000 or so tanks, or 1,500 or so, 25 regiments, after everything works out. And the Pan-Pacific Union is going to get the last, with 24,000 tanks at a solid 100 regiments. Holy shite. That's a lot of Bolos, yes? And we're still a stunning display of mobile firepower. This includes preloaded stockpiles of war shots, given this world's build-up to war, industry will already be on a war footing and to a certain degree be immune to the damage of primary infrastructure, given commanders having already foreseen the need of such strategy, preparing for world war, and move to protect and mobilize its supply situation accordingly. The human wildcard is going to be that all the Bolos can be remotely piloted. Next up is going to be our adversaries. The franchise we are going to be using is Steven Spielberg's Falling Skies, an alien invasion show where aliens show up and immediately brutally push our shit in, leaving mostly civilians to fight a guerrilla war against an inconsistently technologically advanced alien species. And also somehow all the important events somehow take place in and around Boston to Washington, D.C., and involve Professor Jesus, Plot Armor Christ, and his three insufferable crotch goblins. Holy crap, what an annoying set of secondary characters. Our primary antagonists will be the Espheni. Not a lot is known about this elusive race. They are extragalactic, fighting a war on several fronts, losing on some and winning on others. They've allegedly attacked Earth once before, but somehow the Nazca managed to defeat them and then built a bunch of petroglyphs. Celebrating it? Okay. Reasons. Not exactly starting off this invasion thing on the right foot, but we'll continue. Apparently they're psychic. They make use of enslaved mutated foot soldiers, have drone walkers and aircraft, despite having bioengineering far and away more advanced than we have. Their conventional military might appears to be comprised of disposable mechs and fighter bombers, and maybe a generation or two more advanced than contemporary technology based on how easily they're able to destroy them in the show. At least in terms of command and control and material science, if not strategy and tactics overall. I say this as an alpha canon, the basic mechs do not seem to possess any sort of real-world tactical awareness and only seem to behave in a predictable, pre-programmed manner, their only advantage being the durability afforded to them by the material they're constructed of, which also seems to what they use to jacket their ammunition, which functions exactly as any other machine gun or auto gun would operate in universe. And the flimsy excuse given for this is the Espheni adapt their mechs to utilize indigenous ordnance. This material is obviously some sort of chemical-based alloy made of pure bullshittium, because if it were a layered laminate, it wouldn't retain its properties as it's melted down and recast through additional bullets by the character Pope in the series. Well, a potentially meta-stable alloy could theoretically retain all its properties in a specific state despite moving between other various states of matter. We'll go with the bullshittium excuse for the moment. It's lazy and contrived, but hey, that's TNT science fiction for you. So, carrying on. Beamers, on the other hand, are pretty straightforward. They're no more maneuverable than a contemporary fighter in atmosphere. Their defenses include a non-regenerating particle shield. It appears sustained 50 BMG fire can strip and bring down this shield in quick order. And energy projector weapons, and what is called a neutron bomb in the show, but it behaves more like a variable yield warhead bomb, able to switch between explosive potential and hard radiation. Again, appearing to scale from being able to eliminate a single vehicle or squad up to a whole city. And that's going to be pretty much the primary armaments of the Espheni in this engagement. Also, the Espheni seem to place a considerable value on enslaving local populations to serve as disposable cannon fodder in their wars of expansion. And I think that should about cover those goofy looking fish buggers. What do you think, guys? Let's give them some vehicles, shall we? So for this battle, I'm going to give them 250 motherships, 10,000 in air support, 15,000 regular mechs, 2,500 advanced mechs, and their wild cards are going to be orbital dominance and lunar power generator stations, so they don't have to rely on human power stations to repower their artifacts. So before I narrate the scenario to you guys, here's a look at the rules that I chose before I laid this scenario out.
Are you serious?
First things first, humans will be on the defensive. The Espheni will be on the attack. They get the first strike option like they did in the show. Real world physics will count as they do in both universes. Battle charts that I used had the following modifiers on them. The humans will only be able to replace their losses at 50%, decreasing by 10% per year due to orbital bombardment of their ordnance only. The Espheni can only replace their losses at 5%, increasing by 5% per year after the first year of successful occupation. The victory conditions for the humans, all Espheni will be dead on planet side. Victory conditions for the Espheni, They have erected the planetary shield and maintained it for a minimum of 3 months, fatally irradiating the Earth's surface. So this gives us a maximum and minimum time frame for the game, and humans can effectively fight for a maximum of 6 years before attrition renders them combat ineffective. And 3 months for the Espheni if they manage to get their motherships and their towers built to build the defensive grid. And with the basics and rules out of the way, let's get into our scenario, shall we? The Espheni will decloak in high orbit after establishing a lunar power station and immediately begin neutron bombing all major military, government, major population centers, decimating the governments and major military air and IFV units under the opening strikes. Even the mighty Bolo units are heavily affected by the bombardment. Effective fighting regiments left are in the North American Federation, 6, South American, 3, African Union only has 5 regiments left, European Union has 8, and the Pan-Pacific Union has 5 regiments left. Although the Bolos still contain a considerable concentrated combat strength, the command and control needed to deploy them on a planetary scale no longer exists, and all remaining Bolo commanders agree to break up their forces into as small a unit as possible and engage the enemy in asymmetric warfare, drawing the forces away from civilian populations, refugees, and critical infrastructure needed for the war effort. Whereas the Espheni will make planetfall and begin what they believe to be a simple mop-up and crawling operation to harness the indigenous lifeform's children. However, once the Espheni forces are committed, they're going to find themselves facing unreasonable levels of extremely effective resistance. As if the enemy wanted to draw them into a trap, they quickly realize that attempting to locate these threats using their air power is a non-viable option due to the power and accuracy of the indigenous lifeform's missile weapons. So they decide to seek to overwhelm and destroy them using their mechs and mega mechs instead. And in some cases they prove marginally successful in wiping out a few fire teams here and there, but most engagements play out like this, with the Mark IIs maneuvering around them, keeping them occupied, while the Mark IIIs smashed into utter bits with the railguns and howitzers. The Espheni quickly realize the error of their strategy, but too late to recall their forces before the remaining Bolos can annihilate the bulk of their mechanized forces, rendering them essentially combat ineffective in all ground operations from here on out. Capitalizing on the newfound momentum, the humans are going to push back, slaughtering the invaders at every turn, especially when the fate of the Harness Children is brought to light. You're going to see a lot of Bolos with the Espheni skulls strapped to the sides. Ultimately, the invaders are destroyed by a special ops team and their raid on a lunar power station, killing the Queen. But the Bolos were the ones who kept the bulk of their forces occupied and dying, so this could be pulled off. Well, humanity's going to have to rebuild, and they're going to face great hardship doing so. But they're going to be alive to complain about it thanks to the tireless firepower and stalwart dedication of the Dinochrome Brigade. So, recovering from the last episode's monstrous defeat at the hands of the Tyranids, the Bolos have again come out on top and victorious.
Supreme victory!
Showing that even the oldest of these war machines, these venerable monsters, can still fist any hostile force straight in their ass. But that's just this geek's opinion. I'd love to hear your opinion on how this scenario plays out in the comments down below, or you can join the Discord and tell me all about it. Hang and chat and game with us. If you want to help support the channel by helping us get newer and better equipment to provide you with better entertainment, then our Patreon and subscribe part are the place to be. Appreciate any help whatsoever. So join us next time as we pit a special force of Bolos against those sturdy weeaboo space commie blueberries, the Tau Empire. And you'll see me again, and I hope to see you on the next battlefield.